she informed me that her partner lived here in Cordova. And so she's been coming here now and is going to be here for the next several months writing her dissertation. So she's done some fascinating work up in the Arctic. And I don't know, are you going to talk a lot about Schroeber's tonight or just more about the big picture? So,
yeah.
But anyway, so welcome, Lisa.
I arrived just after you guys had like 2 weeks of rain, so I haven't really had any rain yet, so thank you for coming out on a sunny day. This talk is a huge collaborative effort, so when I work for Environment and Climate Change Canada as part of my PhD affiliation, and so I said I'd like to give something that touched upon not just shorebirds, but other Arctic wildlife. And so they suggested and provided me with a smattering of different slides and images and some of the data that's been collected across the Arctic to present today. And when we think of the Arctic, we commonly think of this scenario of barren and empty cold. And for many people, the winter months do look like that. We work quite closely with the Inuit communities, particularly in northern Canada, and a lot of the data today is Canadian, who have taught us a lot about historical Arctic. The Arctic conditions that they've experienced through storytelling and one-on-one interactions and sharing what the Arctic was like across generations. And that has been really valuable for us to understand, okay, we've established surveys and started data collection for the past several decades, but then we have alternative and additional information to add to that. The most northern regions of the Arctic look like this. It could actually be Cordova minus the trees, really. You see glaciers and then these jutting rocks outside of the ice. The Inuit call them nanataks. But in general, the Arctic is composed of a diverse group of habitats that house just wonderful, diverse flora and fauna. This is a picture of the summer sedge meadow in Norway with cotton grass and willow. During prime season, many areas of the Arctic tundra are carpeted with dryest flowers like these. And even within the first bottom inch of most of the tundra, you see a diverse group of species like moss, lichen, things growing within the peat, and then that microscopic community of invertebrates. And I didn't really notice it until I started laying on the tundra while trying to catch shorebirds and getting bored and looking around and thinking, geez, you know, the diversity may be really low-lying, but it's still quite beautiful and very diverse. So the summer months when the Arctic becomes habitable, we have this huge influx of animals, mostly the ones that can get there, and that's your birds. And they fly thousands of kilometers. This is a flock of Kalmar. What is the Arctic? We see, if this is looking at the globe from the top, this is your Arctic Circle. And what I found most interesting about what we classify as the Arctic is if you look at this green line, that's the tree line. And so our Arctic is composed of Russia, Northern Europe, Greenland, Canada, and Alaska. But some of the Arctic is actually classified within the tree line. So we, as a government, did a huge survey assessment of what is in the Arctic, what are the different habitats, and how are they changing. Some of the first surveys within the tree line were done up here in Richardson Mountain between Yukon and Northwest Territories, again, classified as the Arctic. And we found that it's very wet habitat, dense shrubbery and small kind of dwarf trees, the growing season's so short. And it's not easy to get around. Anyone who's done nest searching in Cordova and the surrounding area knows that the large scale that which you have to cover to try to determine what lives there is not easy. And it's treacherous and a little painful. And we've noticed that surveys over time have indicated an increase in density in the shrubby habitat and a tree line that's moving northward. And we believe this is a good indicator of increasing temperatures. But again, classified as the Arctic. If we move above the tree line here in Canada, we get to this region here where surveys were conducted on Southampton Island and kind of southern Baffin Island. And this is where you get the tundra where I work. Low-lying vegetation, very wet, mostly mosses and grasses. And during that snow melt, the tundra is washed with all of that running water, the snow melt, out into the ocean. This is us there, kind of early spring season. There's camp in the background. And Gary, one of our Inuit that worked with us. And you can see that these low-lying areas are really susceptible to water level changes. If we have even, you know, an inch increase in water levels from the ocean, you'd imagine that fairly large proportion of the habitat would become submerged and then no longer available to the wildlife that require land portion. Landlocked mammals on the tundra, or this portion of the Arctic, like peary caribou, rely on lichen. And being a mammal and landlocked, you have to move around a lot to ensure that you obtain all of your resources that you need. Lichen, I don't even know how they survive on lichen and how many nutrients are in it, but they do. Another landlocked mammal is the sly Arctic fox. This is a remarkable animal that I have a terrible relationship with because he depths all of my nests, but they can capitalize on foraging on ice and on land. They live there year-round, and then when the going is great, they cache their food. So they can take eggs, and then they'll dig a little hole, plant their food, they'll mark it with urine or something smelly, and then they'll go back to it from year-round. Isotope analysis has shown that Arctic fox will consume eggs up to a year after they've been cached, and that's how they make it through their winters. The lemming is our little cyclical rodent, much like rabbit populations. They go up and down, they feed everybody. They're like a little wild hamster, I think. And that's how I think of them anyways. And then this, on Southampton Island, there was this plywood board, and we lifted it up. It had been there a while, and we found this lemming. It's really hard to see, but there's this network of tunnels. And so they survive by eating the bark of willow, and then to avoid detection and create their own kind of microhabitat, they burrow all under the ground, which is quite neat. And then they create these little burrows during the winter months and nest during the winter. It's also, the tundra is also lush vegetation for the bird communities. This is a ruddy turnstone nest, and even kind of on a micro scale, this little cup is surrounded by saxifrage and moss and, I mean, a wide variety of plant species. Loons, interesting bird. You see them here in Prince William Sound. They can't walk on land. I'm sure you've seen them try to flop because their hips are so far back. And so they'll nest, they'll build these neat nests out of moss, and then they'll kind of like flop onto it for breeding. But obviously, you know, wide range of birds use the tundra for breeding. Some species, like the red phalarope, spends its entire life out in the ocean and only comes on land to breed. So it, to me, it's much a privilege to capture and monitor red phalarope when that short window of time to see them on land is so short. And when you have any influx of prey items, you have the influx of the predators. So we get aerial predators like herring gulls and parasitic jaeger. Moving north, kind of north Baffin Island, we see the classic typical barren landscape. So you get a little bit more rocky, not kind of void of vegetation. You still get your romping caribou and muskox and polar bear populations, but again, nothing like the tundra for breeding birds. Again, glaciers, this is kind of, you get a little bit of melt, and then your nunataks. And the ivory gull is one that is there. It survives up there by being a scavenger. So when polar bears make a caribou kill, they then survive off feeding off the carcass. And their breeding and population status gives a good idea of what's happening in most northern regions of the Arctic, given that if their populations are declining, you want to go in and assess, and they did do surveys. But some of my favorite favorite areas of the Arctic are along the coastline in Hudson Bay. And for any rock climbers out there, this has got to be the coolest tech work out there. There are these just wonderful cliff edges, and Environment Canada goes in there, and I mean, this is my surprise when he's young. He doesn't go anymore, because like, it's just so ridiculous. But if you look, these are cliff edges, and these are all common myrrh. So they get their one little couple inch cliff edge, and they lay their eggs on this cliff edge, and that's what they get. Logistically, monitoring these guys is almost near impossible. They do have these rock climbers that will tie into these sites, and they go down there and sit in these lines that actually are like angled out to assess, you know, individual breeding. But for the majority of these colonies, all you can do is fly by and take pictures. Common myrrh, the reason why I brought them up is that they have an interesting relationship with the Arctic, and one that's really empirically easy to show. They have a wonderful relationship with ice, such that they are birds, like you've seen here in the Prince William Sound. They can fly, but they can also swim really well, depths of up to 200 meters, and they rely on fish. The Arctic cod communities like to be under ice. That's where their biota are, their safety under there, and as ice retracts away from their little cliff edge that they're stuck to, they have to move further and further to get food. And so as we see decline in ice, we see these birds suffering, particularly the ones at the lower southern limit of their range. For example, this is a piece of ice, and this is a school of Arctic cod trying to hide under this ice. And for scale, these are beluga whales. So again, you know, they make attempts, but we are seeing their food source moving away from their breeding colonies. The Inuit have also expressed concerns. The ice is less predictable. They need to be out on ice hunting seals. They have, even if it's not necessarily to fill their freezer, which in many ways it is, it's part of their tradition, it's part of their heritage, and it's important to them. And it's becoming more and more dangerous. And if you talk to anyone in an Inuit community, they likely know someone or a family member that's either died from exposure or been in a life-threatening situation like this. And this, around these rocky areas, one bird that manages to stay year-round is the common eider. These guys stick it out all year round. And they survive on these polynias, which are open ocean during the winter. And now these little dots are a common eider. And so they use these openings to dive down and get mussels and sea urchins. And they have to keep the water moving around all the time so it doesn't freeze over. And as our ice conditions are changing, availability of designated spots that were commonly polynias based on currents are not there anymore, and the birds are now having to adapt and change to maintain their food sources. There's a common eider with a sea urchin. So the Arctic, is forested areas, scrubby habitat, it's tundra, it's barren landscape, and it's rocky cliff edges, and all of that has a whole helm to these highly adapted wildlife. And we're seeing rapid changes in the habitat. Can we see rapid changes in the wildlife to adapt to these, the new habitat? And so, Elizabeth, will you play the video? So this, you may have already seen this. This is from NOAA. This shows the Arctic sea ice age every week since 1990. And so by 2008, if you just...
So the sea ice covering the Arctic Ocean was dominated by ice that was many years old. This core of old ice survived all year round. Around this core, a smaller fringe of seasonal ice froze each winter and thawed each summer. Old ice eventually drifted out of the Arctic through the Fram Strait. New batches of old ice were built in the Beaufort Gyre. The gyre was a nursery where young ice grew thicker and stronger as it drifted around for many years. Today, summers in the southern branch of the Beaufort Gyre are often too warm for ice to survive. As a result, the amount of thick old ice in the Arctic has declined significantly. In its place is young, thin ice that's likely to melt in the summer. The small amount of old, thick ice makes the Arctic vulnerable to extreme ice retreat in very warm summers. It's a situation that keeps Arctic wildlife and the people who live there poised on the edge of dramatic and possibly irreversible change.
Reports from the Inuit communities say the same thing, and definitely they are trying to make adjustments, but they're a little bit more flexible now with some of the technology, boats, guns, and snowmobiles, but in general, the ice conditions varying, particularly in spring, can make travel very, very dangerous. There's also, we've had several comments from the Inuit community stating that the type of ice and snow is changing, whether it's the physical properties or the porosity that is preventing them from making the quality igloos that they need during the winter months for hunting, which I thought was kind of unusual, but noteworthy for sure. The northerners definitely make comments all the time that, oh, summers are warmer, and the research is reflecting that. So all these surveys that we've been doing over decades are describing the same trends. So we have reduction in ice thickness. Again, thicker the ice, the better it is at buffering against warming conditions or fluctuating temperatures. And then reduction in ice area can start to inhibit animals when they require interacting closely with ice or the communities that live under ice. So we've seen direct effects on habitat, so sea ice, increasing water levels, and changes in the tree line. But there are also a multitude of direct and indirect effects then on the animals. And so today I'm just going to give a few short examples for the polar bear, geese, and shorebirds. The iconic polar bear is one that anyone who works in the north will see and interact with fairly often. Reports are increasing with human interactions, more so in the past couple of years. It's a big part of my job, is just carrying a gun and going to the outhouse. So safety is number one, but what are the bears doing? What do they need? Well, they need ice to hunt. Many of you have probably heard the stories because everybody loves talking about polar bears, being that they are such an interesting animal. And everyone loves the look, but they need ice to then hunt their preferred prey. So seals, ring seal in particular, is what they need to be able to put on enough fat to survive the summer. And a swimming polar bear will never catch a swimming seal. So when these seals go onto the ice to rest, a polar bear will then swim stealthily around these ice pieces and then pop up and grab their prey. And so this is crucial. These types of dynamics with ice are what keep them alive. Bears in Western Hudson Bay, if anyone has heard of Churchill, Manitoba, that is the place where tourists go to see bears because there are so many of them. And you can get a tour or to get up close encounters with polar bears. But unfortunately, so this is just taken from the internet, these bears are losing their hunting season. So as ice break up, occurs earlier, bears are coming inland up to 3 weeks earlier than they should. And that's a lot of feeding time to gain enough fat. A sow with a cub trying to accommodate her cub could go 8 months without eating, and then it could take away 3 weeks of her foraging time. That's a huge chunk. And of course, this all depends on their access to seals. In Churchill, they've seen not only declines in the number of cubs, but then the survival of those cubs, and declines in bear health. I worked with a polar bear biologist with Environment Canada last summer, and I didn't know that much about bears, but he said, if it's running away, and its butt's jiggling like jello, and the whole thing's just wobbly, it's a healthy bear. But if it's running, and you can see its limbs, and it's not got that kind of wiggle to it, it's a skinny bear. Oh my gosh. So belly fat on a healthy bear should be like that thick. And so these bears are going to need alternative food. We have less foraging time. Now it's up to 3 weeks earlier. What about phenology and how this may impact other animals? So we have the timing of breeding for birds. Oftentimes for these northern birds, it's when the snow's gone. Particularly snow geese and cackling geese. This is a goose on its nest. I'm keeping a little profile there. So that they can have successful young. We are seeing consistently that earlier the geese are breeding. And so ice melt is occurring earlier. As soon as that ground opens up, they lay. I mean, they're physically ready. They prep during migration. And so now we have bears coming ashore 3 weeks earlier and geese breeding only 1 week earlier, and eggs are really tasty. So this is a video. Just 1 second for you. This is a common eider colony on Southampton Island where I work. I don't actually work on this particular island, but what you see is there's this bear. They've allowed him to stay on the island, and he will systematically move across. And what you'll see, hopefully, is some like darting of hen common eider, the brown, so the largest one, and the bear eating. And then anything he doesn't get, those flushed common eider will be, their eggs will be dead by the hen gull. So you can just kind of see it's this additive kind of predation effect. So there you can see them kind of skirting around, and then the gulls just move in. So they have actually shown that there's pictures of Florida that have like egg yolk. It's like, and they get fat and happy, and then they just leave. The whole crew just sits there having to wait for this bear. Either that, or then you have to scare it away and just comes back. Because once they get one meal, they're hooked. Now they're getting even more daring with climbing. So not only do you have to be a climber to work here, but then you have to look around every 2 seconds because they're getting more and more agile. And once they feed once, they're back every day. They were evacuated 3 weeks early last summer from up to 18 bears in the first part of their season, which at that point is safety first. So we scrapped the season. So effects on wildlife and habitats are evident. Some are obvious, especially with bears being so visible. But what about maybe some of these complex and hard to predict effects for the changing Arctic? And that's where Arctic breeding shorebirds come in. These are the guys that I study. And not that I need to define a shorebird for the people in this room, but wader birds, they don't swim. They have gorgeous plumage. Except a red fowler will swim like a duck with these kind of cute little semi-palmated feet. Aaron, I can't tell the difference between these two. Thank goodness we have a guide for the Shorebird Festival. They are really hard to identify. At least on the breeding grounds, they have nice distinctive plumage. But shorebirds in general can be a little difficult for birders and obviously a great challenge. They require this open land, shorelines, mudflats, estuaries, grasslands, alpine, and arctic tundra globally. Many of them are migratory. About 50% of them use the Arctic to breed, the tundra, that lush vegetation, and then will migrate down this red knot over 11,000 kilometers. Not sure how many miles that is. They have low reproductive output. They can only lay 4 eggs. They fit all perfectly together. Oh, can't like this. It reduces heat loss. But that short breeding season, they only get one chance. If their nests fail early enough in the season, they may be able to lay a second clutch. But after a certain point, they just don't have time. They're susceptible to change across a range of areas. I mean, if you're going to migrate from the southern tip of South America, you need good quality habitat all the way up and all the way back down again. So, unfortunately, a number of Arctic breeding shorebirds populations are in decline. 80% of the ones we monitor are currently in decline. The the Red Knot was back in, I guess, 2008, 2009, in Canada, was put on the endangered species list. Since then, it's now threatened. But this migratory Olympian, as we call it, it's on the rebound, luckily, to an extent. But if it were to fly and reach its 13th birthday, which is the top range for age, I think, I can find so far, it would fly to the moon and back. That's how much movement these birds are doing in such a short time. But we've been doing a lot of tagging. There's this collaborative international effort, tracking them through MODIS, and we're learning a lot about their breeding habitat and what things we need to protect. But they suffered from the horseshoe crab egg industry in Delaware Bay. Northern communities have also expressed concerns about lack of shorebirds or shorebird declines as they would see it. They categorize all shorebirds in one group as the Sagittiaque. So their concern originally was if the birds weren't around, it was because then they couldn't eat the eggs. But they don't do that anymore. But historically, they ate a lot of like Arctic tern eggs and the Sagittiaque eggs. And what caused these declines? That's an awful big question, considering that every species is different. But definitely one of them is conditions on the breeding grounds. We're seeing changes in the tundra. What are those changes? Well, with increasing water levels, we're getting a lot of flooding and some loss of land. Like I said, that tundra is so low and so wet. The snow goose population in North America, particularly the lesser snow goose, has exploded in the past 40 years. And they are very good at living a long time and having lots of babies and then establishing these colonies that just keep growing. And okay, well that's great, but the problem is what they're doing to the habitat. So this is kind of hard to see, it's grainy, but this is an example of where I work, just outside of a colony. These higher elevation areas would have been moss, carpet, sedge meadow, and then those were the areas that melted first during the spring. Birds came in, grazed it down. Snow melt continued, this is over years. They then started to graze the pond edge, and then when there was no more grazing, they just pulled the tundra right up and then gained access to the shoots and the below substrate of tubers. And then you get desertification, erosion, and then nothing grows. And it's kind of hard and crusty once it dries out. But if you took a moderately grubbed pond and you took the geese away permanently, it would take 15 years for that pond to recover. Just given the short growing season. So what is being done? Well, the surveying, the long-term programs through collaborative efforts internationally. We have monitoring, research on the breeding grounds, and then this wonderful influx of citizen science. And so surveys, again, lots of helicopter time, lots of plane time, hiking. We've surveyed about half of what we consider to be the good breeding habitat in the Arctic through these major volunteer efforts, ASDN. This, where I work and have for the past 4 summers on Southampton Island, is a 20-year-long research camp. And we have the longest known collection of invertebrates in the world. So we were able to have some kind of standard for measuring biomass and invertebrate communities over time. We go to great lengths to get there. Many of these places have roads, which like you guys know about. But planes, helicopters, some people ride in by early season by a comet and snow machine for hundreds of kilometers to get to these sites early enough in the season. And lastly, so the citizen science, you guys have this wonderful shorebird festival coming up, and it's things like this, and eBird, Erin, I'm sure you've really, push eBird. Because all the observations, like this morning, or just now, what you talked about, like what birds are seeing and where and when, can go into these large databases. And papers are published from that material. It becomes peer-reviewed material from these wonderful citizen science efforts. But with that, thank you again for coming. The photos, again, many of them were mine. Some of them were, but mostly Paul Smith and Grant Gilchrist from Environment Canada. Thank you.
So, questions? If I'm curious about the snow geese, is there any way that those, I mean, how many millions of them are there?
Depends on who you talk to. Upwards of 11
million. 11 million.
Nick's been working on breaking it down.
Right, right. But, I mean, what can they do on the breeding grounds? Anything? Or is it all going to have to be on the wintering grounds?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, Arctic Goose Joint Venture gave us a lot of money to study how geese are impacting other birds. That was part of my PhD funding. And I think it's getting to, we need to get to a point where if we have enough backing that the shorebirds and other birds are being affected, that you could cull on the breeding grounds.
But cull on the breeding grounds.
Yeah, I mean, or, I mean, the massive scale of like just even destroying nests would be a huge undertaking, and then you have to deal with the public being okay with it. Because, you know, they're not seeing it. It would just take, like, couple of those advocates to see the tundra in person to know.
But so you're not going to eat it out that you'll see some die-offs.
Well, so, and that's another thing too. Nick, whenever you see something weird on a bird that they shot in Arkansas during that migration, he sends it to me and I've passed it on to some of the pathologists in those states. So we have seen that, what's that for fungus?
Fungus.
Nick, do you remember what it is? That yellow thing that was on his head? We're seeing like some disease, and then we had our first reported cholera outbreak in Saskatchewan last year. And so it's quite possible that we're seeing some plateau, and then it wouldn't be completely unrealistic to see some kind of disease infection.
But on the breeding grounds, so there won't be where they eat out the habitat.
So, and there's so much work done on snow geese and whether or not they're going to eat out their habitat. They've shown that, so once a female, a male, so she incubates, but he sticks around. Once they brood their young, they can move up to 14 kilometers and more. And the further they take their young, the better they grow. So even that extra mobility and keeping their brood moving, they've done better, so they just take them to somewhere where it's good, but that overlaps with all the other breeding birds. And so the fox and everybody else follows the snow geese, and then opportunistically just steps all the shorebird eggs, because the shorebirds will flush, and there's a nest. Yeah. Whether or not they eat them out of house and home, that's doubtful. Yeah.
Is there any idea what's driving that boom?
Yes. Agricultural practices during the flyway. They arrive on the breeding grounds just plump and corn-fed, and their survival's great, and they have huge clutches, and they get great genetic mixing, so a female lesser snow goose goes back to her same cup, but she will hook up with a male during migration, so you get this kind of mixing where males will go to different colonies, but the female goes back. So they're strong.
So the timing on snow geese is about a week earlier than in the past, you said?
Mm-hmm.
What about shorebirds? Are they coming back a little earlier than normal?
It fluctuates. And when we say climate change, again, it's almost just more volatile. So one year it's just a horrible spring and the snow geese didn't breed at all, which is rare but still occurring. And then on a great year, everybody's booming. But shorebirds, yes, we're seeing just slight increases with the geese.
But generally, shorebirds have an incubation period that might be, 18 to 22 days, and snows are 26 days. So theoretically, the precocial shorebird young should be away from the nest. nest and the eggs have already hatched by the time that the snow geese are still incubating and the plovers have been.
I wish. Well, so at least in Nunavut, in our study area.
You're talking about Southampton.
Southampton, correct. The snow geese are initiating earlier than the shorebirds.
Yeah.
So they don't, the females don't need to forage. So as soon as they get there and there's some open habitat,
right.
They don't need to eat, they can nest. Whereas shorebirds have this kind of more incoming cavalry mixing strategy, so they do need to be able to feed. And so if there's just no habitat, they'll move out and then they'll keep checking in. And so we get peak hatch of snow geese the first week of July and peak hatch of shorebirds like a week later. So they're bringing their young to these better habitats to forage that overlaps with just like kind of peak area.